which is an end. This is an excellent chance for you to ask questions on how independence will affect us here at Caithness. I'd also like to thank the Scottish Cabinet for their visit to the far north, and it really does demonstrate their commitment to the whole of Scotland. Really quickly, we're going to do some housekeeping. We're not expecting a fire alarm tonight, but if there is one, there's fire exits here to the side and outside the front door as well. If you need to use the facilities, the ladies and gents are also out by the front door and up the stairs. And if we can please make sure that all our mobile phones are turned off and turned to silent and respect those speakers. Thank you. I'll now hand you over to Joe Fitzpatrick, who is our chair for the evening. He's the Minister for Parliamentary Business. Thank you.
Mainland that the Cabinet had reached, so it's really good for us to make it young people something to do and help local communities. Alec Neil visited the Company House care home here in Wick. Fiona Hislop and Robson and I went to Thurso. When I was there, visited the Citizens Advice Bureau and was able to announce a 3-year extension and an additional £2.5 million of funding for our community broadband scheme, which is the scheme that is designed to supplement our main programme to deliver next generation broadband to premises across the country. It's designed very much to make sure we can get good quality internet access into every part of Scotland, regardless of how remote or rural these areas might be. I know Shona was visiting one of the community sports hubs that are a key legacy of the Commonwealth Games, and of course the Commonwealth Games get underway in my home city of Glasgow in just over a week's time. There's great excitement about that in Glasgow, and I know across the country, I understand the Queen's Baton made it to Caithness just a few days ago, and I hope many of you had the opportunity to see it while it was here. Fiona got to go to the pictures, cinema in Thurso. Did you see a film? You did see a film. Well, can you tell us about that latest bit, see the success that story there that is supported by Highlands and Islands Enterprise. And just to prove that there's real benefit in having the cabinet in your local area, I've got one more announcement for you this evening. This evening I can tell you, and this will be of interest I'm sure to everybody in Wick, but particularly perhaps those of you who have children, that the Scottish Government and Highland Council have reached an agreement to regenerate the Riverside Play Area, which is near the Cockhill Bridge in Wick. Those of you who are familiar with that play park will know that the equipment had to be removed because of the poor condition it was in. It had to be removed on safety grounds. So we now have a proposal to replace that equipment. It's a proposal led by Wick Gala Committee, and the Scottish Government is contributing £40,000 to the £100,000 cost of that, and we're delighted to be able to help get that really important facility back up and running for the young people of this area. So these are all the evening. Sometimes, although it's an absolutely legitimate country, yes, but nevertheless a country that has made such an incredible, disproportionate contribution to the world down the generations. I read a book some years past that I'm sure all of my colleagues have read as well. A book by a guy, a Canadian guy, called Arthur Herman, entitled How Scotland Invented the Modern World. And when you think about it, that's not too far from the truth. Think about all the inventions and innovations that are famous to us now, from the telephone and the television, tarmac, ultrasound, the overdraft, but all of them are things we want to boast about. More modern times, Dolly the Sheep, one of the greatest scientific innovations of recent times. Grand Theft Auto. How many people here played Grand Theft? I never have, but my nephew does. But a computer game played the world over, invented, developed here in Scotland. So we're a country that has made an incredible contribution to the world in the past, and I'm sure we will in the future. And yet we still find ourselves asking, have we got what it takes to be independent? Well, the answer to that question, the simple, straightforward, and absolutely true answer to that question is yes, we do have what it takes to be independent. We're a country blessed with extraordinary resources. We are rich in human talent. If you look at what is the standard measure of a country's economic strength, the standard measure of how wealthy a country is, which is our GDP per head, our wealth per head of population. By that measure, an independent Scotland would be the 14th richest country in the world. By that measure, we are wealthier than France, Japan, we're wealthier than the UK as a whole. The UK is number 18 on that list, which is not a bad position to be in, incidentally, but we'd be four places above that. And interestingly, when you look at the countries that sit above us in that league table of wealthy countries, you tend to find they are small countries. The Norways, the Denmarks, the Swedens of this world. Now sometimes when I make those points, people will look back and say, ah but, that, you know, the Scottish thing, we always say ah but, it's all based on oil. Well, sure, oil is a big, big advantage, big bonus in our economy. We're very lucky to have oil. Our economy is not based solely on oil, far, far from it. We've got enormous strengths in many other sectors, food and drink, modern manufacturing, creative industries, tourism, farming, fishing, and other key growth sectors. We've also got vast potential in renewable energy. We've got quite amazing strengths in higher education and research. We've got more of the world's top universities per head of population than any other country on the face of this planet. When you think about that, that's a pretty good position to be in. So it's not all about oil, don't let anybody ever tell you that it is. One of the big credit rating agencies, the big organisations that determine how creditworthy countries are, Standard & Poor's, published a report a few months ago looking at prospects for an independent Scotland, and it said even taking out of Scotland's account all of the revenue from North Sea oil and gas and looking only at our onshore income, an independent Scotland would still qualify for their highest economic assessment. So we're a rich country, a very rich country. And the last point on this is that we're not subsidised, no matter what some others would have you believe. Do you know that in each and every one of the past 33 years, that's almost, not quite, but almost as long as I've been alive, well, that's a slight exaggeration, but not too much of one, but in each and every one of the past 33 years, we've generated more tax per head of population than the UK has as a whole. Now, in some of those years, oil prices will be high, some of those years, oil prices will have been low, but we still generated more tax per head of population. Now, if you look at the last 5 years, our public finances, albeit in a time of economic difficulty and public finances of countries around the world being in less than healthy states, our public finances have been stronger than the UK's to the tune of £8.3 billion. That's about £1,600 for every person in Scotland. So my first message to you this evening is this one. we choose to be independent, it's a choice that all of us individually and as a country collectively we will make on the 18th of September. But if we choose a future as an independent country, then we will start life as an independent country with robust public finances and with a strong and varied economy. And that's an incredible foundation for any country to start out its life as an independent country. So, my plea to you tonight, and it's a plea from the heart, however you decide to vote, and obviously I hope all of you decide to vote yes, but if you decide not to do that, please, please don't let it be because somebody somewhere has convinced you that Scotland's not big enough, and strong enough, and rich enough to be an independent country. Nothing, absolutely nothing, can be further from the truth. The issue in this debate, in my view, is not whether we're wealthy enough to be independent. The big issue, the big question, is why so many people in Scotland don't feel the benefit of the enormous wealth that we have as a country. And that goes to the heart of the real debate. Why should we become an independent country? Now, let me say at this stage, very frankly, independence isn't a magic wand. We won't wake up the morning after we become independent to find that all of our problems are gone and all of the challenges we face as a country have disappeared. An independent Scotland will face challenges, we will have ups and downs like any other country does. So it's not a magic wand. And anybody who tries to tell you that it is should be treated with the same disdain as the person who tries to tell you that Scotland is too poor to be independent. What independence is a massive opportunity. It's the greatest opportunity we will ever have as a country to build a better, more prosperous and fairer country for ourselves and for generations to come after us. At the very core, at the very heart of the argument for independence lies this belief, this conviction, and that is that it will always be better for all of us if the decisions about Scotland, the decisions that shape the kind of country we are taken by the people who care most about Scotland, and that's those of us, all of us, who live here, who work here, who run businesses here, who raise children here. We won't always get it right, but we will have more chance of getting it right because we've got the biggest stake in these decisions than anybody else ever will. Nobody else will ever do a better job of running Scotland than those of us who live here will do. Above all, therefore, a belief in independence is a belief in the ability of the people of this country. It boils down to, are we confident in our own ability to make a better job of running Scotland than others at Westminster? You see, for Westminster, Scotland will rarely be a top priority. And not because they have it in for Scotland, but because MPs from Scotland account for just 9% of all of the MPs in the House of Commons. So it stands to reason the needs, the interests, the priorities of Scotland will rarely be those of the House of Commons. And of course, sometimes, as has been the case in recent times, decisions are taken by Westminster despite the fact that the overwhelming majority of MPs from Scotland, and indeed the overwhelming majority of people in Scotland, oppose those decisions. Think of the poll tax 25 years ago, the bedroom tax more recently. So I want to set out to you briefly this evening just some of the costs to families, to communities and to individuals from Westminster decisions, but more importantly to outline the benefits for communities of having the powers that currently lie at Westminster here in Scotland instead. And I'm going to focus particularly on jobs and public services. You'll know that the Westminster government has decided to pursue a policy of almost permanent austerity. It wants to cut day-to-day public spending as a proportion of national income to the lowest level it's been since 1948. And the government of Westminster is not doing that because it thinks that's what's required for the economy. It's doing that because they have an ideological belief in a smaller state and reduced public spending. In an independent Scotland, we have the ability to take a different approach. We would operate within a framework of strong and sustainable public finances. As long as John Swinney's in charge, that will always be the case. But we can choose to invest in public services and reject that Westminster austerity approach. And the current Westminster government, of course, is doing more than just cutting public services, it's privatising public services as well. It sold off the Royal Mail, despite huge opposition in Scotland, which is may in future, of course, have implications, yes, for all of Scotland, but particularly for people living in rural communities. And we now know that's a decision that's cost the taxpayer about £1 billion because it was sold off at less than it should have been. And there are already fears for the universal six-day-a-week universal delivery service. We're also seeing privatisation of the health service in England. Health campaigners south of the border are raising real alarms about privatisation of the health service. And that's, in my view, a terrible, terrible prospect for people in England. But it will have damaging knock-on effects for us in Scotland too. If private money replaces public money in England when it comes to the funding of our health service, which is presumably what's going to happen, and that leads to reduced public spending for the health service in England, then that automatically triggers cuts through the Barnett formula to public spending in Scotland. So Westminster privatisation will harm the health service and our public services here in Scotland. In an independent Scotland, decisions about spending, decisions about economic policy are taken here instead, and they're taken in a way that suits and meets the needs and priorities of people here. We continue to pay our taxes as we do now, but instead of sending the revenue from those taxes to the Treasury in London and have them decide how much comes back, we keep that revenue here and we determine ourselves the priorities on which it should be spent. And we set out how, with independence, we can make savings of £600 million a year just by not spending money on things like nuclear weapons and the cost of the House of Lords. Instead, we can do things like invest in childcare to make life easier for young families. I want to just say a word now particularly about benefits to rural communities. We've published today, to coincide with the Cabinet, this document, which I think you've all got copies of, Connecting Rural Scotland. It sets out how, with additional powers that currently lie in Westminster, we can boost tourism and create jobs by, for example, cutting and then abolishing air passenger duty, something that is stifling tourism in our country where we should be trying to do everything we can to grow that sector. It sets out how, with powers over fuel duty, we could look at doing more to address the high fuel prices that do so much damage to our rural and island communities. We can help to increase digital connectivity. I've already spoken about some of the work the government is doing through next generation broadband and the initiative I was announcing today about Community Broadband Scotland. But if we have powers over regulation, we can insist that mobile service providers can do more to improve coverage across Scotland. So this document sets out how we can do so much more if we complete the powers we already have with those powers that currently lie elsewhere in Westminster. These are the big opportunities, just some of the big opportunities that come to Scotland with independence. We can represent ourselves in Europe. If we don't become independent, then we risk being taken outside of the European Union against our will. If the David Cameron in-out referendum goes the wrong way, with independence we can represent our own interests in Europe at the top tables, which will have massive advantages for Scotland as a whole and for our fishing and farming communities in particular. You know, if we've been independent as a country at the last round of negotiations to determine farming payments and rural funding, we would have benefited to the tune of about €3.5 billion more from the European Union just by negotiating as an independent member state. So these are some of the big advantages that come from taking control of our own future. We can have an economic policy that puts Scotland first. We can make sure that policy is tailored to help us meet the challenges we will face and to build on the massive strengths we have as a country. Success for Scotland, just like success for any other country, doesn't fall into our laps. It doesn't happen automatically. But independence gives us the powers to shape it and to achieve it by using those powers in a way that is right for Scotland. So that's the fundamental reason for independence. I hope I've given you some food for thought tonight on the question of can we do this, and I hope I've helped to persuade you that not only can we do this, but we should do it. When you walk into the polling station on the 18th of September, 9 weeks on Thursday, there'll be lots of issues that will help you make up your mind. You'll hear lots of the detailed questions tonight that are all important. But when the questions have all been asked and they've all been answered to the best, in the best possible way that they can, this will boil down to whether we have confidence in ourselves to take the decisions, use the powers, access our own resources to build a better country for ourselves and for our children and our grandchildren. I have absolute confidence in this country of ours and in its people. If we all have that confidence, then we win the ability to